I am Brad Keelor. He is Allen Marr. Next up on Director's Cut, find out how he got his start in earthworks on the banks of a creek in North Carolina. Hello again, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Director's Cut. My name is Brad Keelor. I'm the director of the Geo-Institute, and that is why we call this show Director's Cut. Every week, I sit down with a different GI member who has loads of stories to tell about themselves. If you don't know anything about the Geo-Institute, I think this is a good time for you to find out some stuff. You can head on over to geoinstitute.org when you are done watching this episode of Director's Cut. And when you are there, you will find out that we are a technical society with about 12,000 members, most of whom are geotechnical engineers and or geologists. If you like what you see today, and I guess I can guarantee that you will. You should click subscribe. You should click get notifications, and we will let you know every time we post something to the YouTube channel. With those things said, let's welcome our guest for this week. Coming to us from, is Massachusetts a Commonwealth? The Commonwealth of Massachusetts, the founder and CEO of Geocomp. It is Allen Marr. Allen, welcome.
Thank you, Brad. Thank you for asking me to do this with you. I look forward to it.
We are going to have a good time, as we always do on Director's 10 questions. There are two that we ask every single guest. We will begin with one of those. Describe your job in 45 seconds.
Oh, boy, that's a lot to get into 45 seconds. I focus in Geocomp on mostly on strategic aspects of our company, driving us forward to be a growing company, and also on advancing our technical capabilities. I try to stay out of most administrative work. I'm a technical guy. I love to do technical things, and I love to work with our technical people.
When you go to your LinkedIn page, though, the first job listed, if you click more and you scroll all the way down, the first job that's listed is miner. That is not something you see every day. Can you tell everybody about that job, how you got into it, and what it was like?
Sure. I needed to work my way through university as an undergraduate, I paid my own way, so I needed money. So my father worked for a tunnel contractor, and he was able, when I turned 18, to get me into the union and get me on the crews. And I went everything from driving spikes to hold the railroad together to eventually to the miner, where I would run a drill, load dynamite, and then help with the mucking. And so it paid well for that time. Amazingly, I think I made $10.15 an hour. And I got time and a half for overtime. And so I worked everything I could. And I was able on summer times and some of the holidays, I made enough money to have my own car and pay all my college expenses.
That is incredible. I guess the obvious question here is, what were your favorite and least favorite parts of the job?
Oh, that's interesting too. Good question. I loved it. Anybody who works in tunnels many people who work in tunnels just get used to the smell of a tunnel, the diesel smoke, the rhythm cycles, the pressure to outdo the other crews. It's very much a teamwork environment. So that I love that part. And we were all rushing. If we got two rounds in a shift, we could go home early, you know, and that meant a lot. Going home 15 minutes early, that was a big deal, you know. So so that part I loved. I loved the work itself, working in the rock. It really, really blossomed my interest in geotechnical engineering, I think. My least favorite part was it was dangerous. And, I was very fortunate that I didn't get hurt or killed. At that time, it was acceptable. I think the rule was a death a mile. So it gives you an idea of the work, and it was a problem. That's why I didn't stay in it forever. So I worked off and on there for a couple of years with my father, which was good, and then I moved on.
That's a great story, and I hope not a lot of people knew that, because that's what we strive to do here on Director's Cut, is bust those stories wide open. So you said some of this stuff is what made you love geotech, and maybe around the same time, you started out in undergrad as a structural engineering student, and you switched to geotech. What led you to do this, other than, of course, the wonderful community that we have in the geotechnical world?
Well, like many young people who are trying to consider a career, I didn't have a clue that geotechnical engineering even existed. I trying to decide, I knew I wanted to go to college. What do I do? I run the normal things, doctor, lawyer, and looked at the catalogs as to what kind of courses one would take. The thing that really caught my attention was when I got to the civil engineering curriculum. And I started seeing things like analysis of structures, design of concrete. And I said, yeah, that sounds like what I would love to do. So I enrolled in the structural I enrolled in civil engineering, but I focused on structures. Took all the courses, took most of the master's degree graduate courses in structures as an undergraduate. And then I took soil mechanics course. And that was the first I really knew anything about geotechnical engineering. It was called soil mechanics at the time, and I loved it. You know, I'm back doing earthwork on the banks. I'm in the laboratory making samples, doing tests, and it was great. So I decided that was like the end of my junior year. I got a job that summer working in the UC Davis laboratories, and then I applied to graduate school at MIT in geotechnical engineering, and fortunately was accepted.
What was Davis like at that time? I think most people who, you know, hear something UC in the 60s, we think we know what Berkeley was like, and maybe UCSF and maybe Santa Cruz. But what was Davis like at that time?
Yeah, it was really interesting. It was a bicycle campus, and it was spread out quite a bit. I think there were around 10,000 students at the time. And so almost everyone had a bicycle. And you went to your classes on a bicycle, you did your social interactions on a bicycle. So that really set an atmosphere in the campus, you know, of kind of a bit of a rural or agrarian setting, relaxed, you know, without the distractions of city life. In fact, I found it a little boring and almost and heavily considered transferring to Berkeley in my sophomore year, because I felt like I was missing out on life. Fortunately, I didn't, because I would probably have sunk there with too many diversions. But I stayed at Davis, and it was a good decision.
I think I always felt the same way. If I had gone to a much bigger school, I'm not sure I would have made it all the way through. And who knows where I'd be today.
Well, so Davis has grown great. Davis has gone to 26,000 yeah. students and plans to keep going. We've got amazing programs in a wide number of different things, very much into equality and diversity. And so we go back, we try to go back once a year or so, and we keep up with some of our classmates from there.
That's fantastic. We're going to make you think even further back now. What is the first hobby or activity that you really, really loved? And the follow-up to that is it something you're still interested in today?
So when you asked that question, I thought about it. And I, back to my favorite, quite young. I was a small boy on the farm, not much in the way of toys, no TV, none of those kinds of things that people take for granted today. So I had to make my own toys and find my own diversions. And my mother would often find me out in the creek. Creek's a small stream, on the bank with a piece of wood, making roadways in the banks of the creek. And I was meticulous about getting it at the right width and the right slope and how to make a turn to go back on yourself and get further up the bank. I would do that for hours, and I make a noise with my mouth like small boys do, and I was perfectly happy with that. My mother, even later in life, would comment about how many times she found me just perfectly cheerful, sitting in the creek making roads.
So that dalliance with structural engineering at the beginning of undergrad, that was just noise. It was something you had to get out of the way to get back to your true love.
Well, I got to say, though, having a background in structures, a strong background in structures, I think really helps being a good geotechnical engineer. And today I kind of consider myself and call myself sometimes a geostructural engineer, because, you know, a lot of what I get involved in is things like excavation support systems, complicated foundations, and those things really involve working together, making the structure and the soils and the water work together in combination. So I benefit a great deal from having had background in both disciplines.
So you sort of answered that follow-up question, whether you're still interested in this today, because I guess you are, because, you know, you get paid to do some of that. Do you ever find yourself on the beach or on a creek bank with a stick making some roads?
Oh, gee. No, I don't have much time to do that anymore. Although if I'm sitting on the beach, which I do occasionally get a little time to do, we have a house in Pacific Palisades, and I'll find myself inevitably digging a hole and watching the sides cave in when I get below the water table. That is the water level.
There's something mesmerizing about that.
I'd love to go through our laboratory and see samples being prepared, seeing tests that have failed, and trying to digest what that all means. So I'm still very close to it. I can't go to a project. I'm like any geotechnical engineer. My hands in the dirt almost immediately.
That is fantastic. I have to ask about your awards. There have been a lot in the past several years, whether it's your NAE induction, whether it's the SEED lecture. I think that was 2019 in Philadelphia. You were inducted into the MOLES in the past, I think 2018 maybe. Does it make you have a different view on success in your career? I mean, I think about myself, and I think what I would define as success now is much different than what I would have said if somebody had asked me that question when I was 25. So how has it impacted your definition of professional success?
Well, I really appreciated the receiving those things. I never expected it. I never lobbied for it. And so it's even better when your colleagues and recommend you or propose put you forth for these things. It's very meaningful. But I don't think it's changed me that much. Give me a little bit of a sense of confidence, you know, that I sometimes would think, gee, I'm not very good at this. And, what I do is not very important. And to get a recognition kind of helps offset that lack of confidence. I don't think it's really changed me a whole lot. The thing that really jacks me up is to get a honest compliment from a client or a colleague or a coworker or an employee who genuinely praises me for something I've done. I had that happen last week where someone that I highly respect made some very complimentary things about me and Geocomp, and I almost brought a tear to my eye. It was so fundamental. That's a hell of a lot more meaningful than a plaque on the wall.
Still, though, I would imagine maybe not shocking, but which one of these was the most surprising when you got the call?
Oh, the National Academy. National Academy of Engineering is a very special place, and it's people like me in business. We don't write lots of papers ordinarily. We don't, gather lots of awards or do lots of invited lectures, and so to be selected for the Academy as a representative from the business side was one unexpected and a huge honor. And I go every annual meeting, and I still just feel like, how did I get here?
The question I ask everybody who comes on Director's Cut who's been inducted into the NAE, do you ever look at the list of names on the website or in person when you're down here? I have to think it's a little bit of a surreal feeling to see some of the other names on that list, and then there you are.
It absolutely is, and it never ceases to captivate me. The first time I went, and I was sitting and having dinner with, I was having a brunch with the man who was leading the F-35 project for the most advanced fighter. And we were just sitting there talking about farming. It was absolutely incredible experience. I met the man who invented the CPAP machine. And you sit there and say, what am I doing here? What's my story that can be as fascinating as what these people have done or are doing? And so it's wonderful to be able to get out of your own domain and interact with some of these people who've had major impact. And I feel very proud to be a part of the engineering profession every time I go there.
Hopefully they go home and they say the same thing about you to their families.
The night there was a cocktail party the night before the induction ceremony for all the new entrants that year. And so I went to that, and then there were some of the officials and people roaming around the room, and someone whom I've forgotten came over to me and was talking with me a little bit and asked me what I did and everything. He says, well, you were probably standing in here wondering how the hell did they select me to get into this place? And I said, how did you know? That's exactly what's on my mind. He says, every one of us in this room feels that way. So
that's great. The other question that we ask everybody else, and this will be a little bit of a nostalgia one here too. How did you first get involved in ASCE and then later on GI, once GI existed?
While I was an undergraduate, I was, I think the junior year, I forget which year, I got involved in the ASCE student chapter. And I was pretty active, and I liked politics at that time, and so it was a natural thing to do. I became president of that chapter. I can't remember now if it was 1 or 2 years, but you know, having that involvement and feeling a part of a group was good. And then I think I also went to a few conferences when it was still Soil Mechanics and Foundation Engineering. So being able to interact with names that had written papers I had read, it was just amazing. And then when the Geo-Institute started, I remember sitting in discussions at Berkeley arguing about changing the name from Soil Mechanics to Geotechnical Engineering. And, sitting in Davis Hall there is pretty amazing, too, to listen to this, hearing people like Harry C. Bill Lamb take different positions on that change. So I guess I was involved in small ways. And then I got involved. I've been involved in a technical publications committee for a long time. Hopefully I've had a little impact there. And I've never had an office and held an office in the Geo Institute. Most of my work has been committee stuff and helping out where I can.
But you've done a great job. We're fortunate to have you, and we thank you for all the things you've done for the Institute over the years. Now, I must say, personally, I'm pretty happy. I like the ring of GI. I don't think SMI would be quite the same the same thing. So I don't know how it would look on the shield. I'm kind of happy we went with GI.
Well, it was a good move. Soil mechanics always kind of left the rock mechanics people feeling out, out, whatever. And so it was a good move.
To bring more people into the tent, as Cord Wisman would say. We talked briefly, or we've brought it up a couple of times, I guess, farming. You lived on a farm when you were a kid. I think everybody who has any farming in their blood, I was the first generation in my family to not live on a farm, but a lot of people in the family still had a farm. I'm very familiar with many of the chores and got sucked into doing things like hay over the years, which for our viewers, if anybody ever asks you if you want to do hay, the correct answer is no. Alan, what were your favorite and least favorite chores on the farm as a kid?
Well, I'll start with my least favorite. I remember this so well. You know, my father was, when he first started in construction, he worked away from home. during the week and came home on the weekends. And so that left my mother having to milk the cow every morning and every evening. She had six kids. I was the oldest. I was on that time on the order of about 5 years old. And I had to get up early and go with her to the barn. And my job was to hold the cow's tail so it wouldn't swish her in the face as she sat there and tried to milk the cow. And on the mornings when it had been raining and the cow had been sleeping in the muck in the stall, that cow's tail was a kind of a mess to hold. So I hated that. And once my mother used to tell the story, she looked around and I wasn't there. And I had found a twine that you used to bale hay with, and I had tied the cow's tail to a nail on the wall and went away.
So, I believe that's called an engineering solution right there.
So my most favorite as a young boy on the farm was when my father trusted me enough to drive the truck, which I was, again, about 6 or 7 years old, could barely reach the pedals. But he would let me drive the truck as he and my grandfather walked behind and tossed the loose hay into the bed of the truck. I thought I was something doing that.
That's pretty exciting. What did you guys have on the farm? I mean, what was your favorite crop that you grew? I think anybody who's been around a farm, I remember picking peaches and just eating them right there. And that was like one of the best things ever. What was it for you?
Well, we didn't grow much in the way of fruit. My grandfather had an orchard, so we got our fruit from there, and that was always great when the fruit came in, and we had fresh stuff picked right off the tree. That was great. I love the smell of fresh hay. I still do to this day. There's nothing like it. I guess the other favorite thing is, you know, I said we were subsistence farmers, so we had a very large garden, and my mother and father would can food for the winter. And I loved some of the fresh vegetables. Our food was very subsistence, very simple, meat and potatoes, but it was always great. My mother was a great cook, so that was my favorite part.
With planning the garden for the year last month and everything, I got super nostalgic for all this, except potatoes. Potatoes was mine that I hated because they were just a lot of work. It wasn't fun to have anything to do with the potatoes.
Well, we had tobacco as a cash crop. We were allotted by the government 3/10 of an acre, which is enough to, I think the annual income from that was $600. And that was the cash source, that and cutting logs. But it was a lot of work. My job as a small boy was to pull the worms off of the tobacco stalks, the tobacco worms, and squash them between my toes with my bare feet. That wasn't necessarily a fun job.
I would imagine not. I'm kind of happy I didn't grow up in the Southeast. One thing that I always think about, yet I've never asked anybody this question on Director's Cut before. What one word do you hope people never use to describe you?
Dishonest. I try to be true to myself and true to my word. I really try. And so if someone accuses me of not living up to what my word was, I find that hurtful.
On the flip side, and you can't say honest because you used dishonest, we can't go the antonym route here. What one word do you hope they use to describe you?
Reliable.
That's good. You didn't go down the side. I'm impressed. That was quick. I think a lot of people would have really struggled with that one. So I want to ask about something unique that you got to do pretty early in your career, and that was go to the Soviet Union for an international conference in 1973 and get some of your reflections, both personally and professionally, from this trip. It was, for anybody who was old enough before communism fell to have any memories, it was a really different world, even into the late 80s. So what was your USSR trip like?
Oh, it was fascinating. 10 days, or I think you know, a lot of anxiety going there. I remember we went to Paris and from there got on to Aeroflot, Russian Airlines, and big concern. Can we touch this thing? Can we rely on it? Is it going to get us there? And I was sitting next to Chuck Ladd, a professor, passed away from MIT, and Chuck had his watch and he was counting. And so I said, what are you doing? He said, well, I usually just count how many seconds it takes for us to lift off. And it tells me how things are doing. And I said, well, what's typical? And he said, well, usually under 40 seconds. And we were at 50 seconds and he was still counting. And I said, oh my God. So that was the start of a trip to Russia. We got there and we'd prepaid our hotel and subsistence for the week. They had no record of it. We had to pay it again. So it's just a lot of things. Russia didn't work very well at that time, and they were really short of a lot of things. But it was fascinating culturally. I remember, we went to dinner one night, and it was in an old theater, been converted to a restaurant with tables and a dance floor. And I remember sitting down and looking around the room, and there was a lot of the males there were in military uniform. And I just thought it was really strange that I'm sitting here with the enemy, so to speak, at that time, because we had been brought up in school to that there was a big threat. I was a part of the duck and cover where kids in school went under their desk. And here I am sitting with these people. And so I'm thinking about that, and then I feel a tap on my shoulder, a fairly solid tap. And I looked around, and it was a fairly robust Russian woman. I'm not trying not to be disrespectful, but it struck me that she was a pretty good proportions. And big grin on her face, pointing to the dance floor, pointing to me and pointing to the dance floor. That was just the opposite of what my thoughts had been about the people in the room. So I got up and danced with her, and found that just extraordinary.
What was the conference itself like? I mean, I know a lot has been made about space cooperation between the U.S. and the USSR and things like the Apollo-Soyuz project in the mid-70s and a little bit beyond. And that was a lot of our kind of scientific diplomacy in the U.S. But I do think it maybe not trickled down, but it extended to a lot of other areas. How did you feel about that when you were at the conference, and then any follow-on you might have had with anybody that you met there?
Yeah, I found the people I met that were kind of mostly Russian academics, you know, they're like the rest of us. They like geotechnical engineering and love to talk about it. They love to talk about their work. We made a visit to Moscow State University. Don't remember too much about it, but they were very open, and just like in some respects, that was just like going to some other country on a professional trip.
And the final question about this, hey, you mentioned sitting next to Chuck Ladd and taking off and probably being more unnerved than you were before after his countdown there. Did you notice any dichotomy between you and your peer group, the people who were about your age on the trip, and the older people? Between, you know, how nervous people were, or what their expectations were out of the trip?
That's interesting. Not so much between the older people, but people from different cultures. So, for example, we had been warned to not bring in, money that's black market money, that they would take it away from you if they found it. So we exchanged our money in Paris, I think, at a very unfavorable exchange rate for us. And we got there and found that everything was that they had, which was limited, was quite expensive. Our colleagues coming from places like Finland and Sweden just blew away on that. And they got four times as many rubles as we did for their money. So they were having a great time in Russia, particularly drinking. That's what struck me, is that having kind of the familiarity with Russia gave you a much different experience, at least from my perspective, than what I had, having been told to obey the rules and trying to obey the rules. So, and I often felt we were followed at night, so I didn't want to push anything. So I didn't have too many drinks in Moscow.
Probably a good idea at that time. So we have one final question here, and it's going to be, I don't know if it's a multi-parter, but it's going to lead into some other stuff here. You, of course, were the founder of Geocomp. You've been the CEO almost 40 years, I think. What part of the Geocomp story history is most remarkable to you when you think back at the breadth of it, whether it was the very beginning or whether it's, you know, with the events of the last couple of weeks, which I'll let you mention instead of me doing it?
You know, there's so many things, it's hard to single out anything, but I think just the remarkable fact that we survived and we grew. And we grew into a successful firm that has a pretty good reputation nationally and internationally now. I think that's remarkable. When I started, I didn't have a business plan. I really was pretty dumb. I got a phone number separate from the house number, went into my office, which was in my house, and waited for the phone to ring. It never rang. Nobody knew about me. Nobody knew about Geocomp. So I pretty quickly had to learn a different way of doing things. And the fact that I got from that start to today we just yesterday became a part of a large international company, CGG, which is a French company traded on the stock exchange and has a subsidiary company called Sercel, which focuses on instrumentation, monitoring, measurements worldwide, and found what Geocomp does as being very attractive. I wanted to assure the future of our people. I'm getting close to retirement age, so we need to do something there. And we found a great partner, great synergistic partner, I think, and strategically well aligned. So to have started from the beginning of just me, and at the time I did have a partner that lasted about a year. I mean. And gotten to this place and have done pretty well for it, to be called on to help people on significant projects in trouble, and our people be asked to give lectures and participate in professional things. I'm very proud of that. I never had any idea of where we would go to, and I have no disappointments really for where we've gotten to.
So what this is going to lead to is, over the summer, GI will be producing a new series on members, ASCE members, not just GI members, who have started their own companies. And we'll be focusing more on the business aspects of this than the technical ones. I am sure there will be technical things that will come up during the course of the conversation. Allen is going to be our first episode, and we're really excited about this. I think we're going to have amazing conversations as we go throughout this series. So for the final thing, your last bonus question here, Allen, we were talking a little bit before we started recording today about why it's important for our members and for the geotech community and the civil community to hear these stories. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, it's... I found in my experience lecturing at universities, you know, I give a technical lecture and that's good, but I found the young people really do like to hear, at least in my experience, you know, of, you know, how I've gotten to where I am, how I do things, how I look at things, how I make decisions, and I think that's a good thing. I think, you know, we probably don't in this internet age, we don't talk and listen to each other enough. Society over time, the way we learned and passed knowledge was talking, if you think about it. Yeah. It's been supplemented somewhat now with, you know, lots of other devices, but it's built into us. And so, I think the opportunity, I love the opportunity to get with students and just informally shoot the bull, as we say.
Well, we hope you can do that in this first conversation and bring some of these I won't call them tips, but life lessons maybe onto our membership and to our viewers. So you survived all the director's cut questions and you did it with flying colors. I tell everybody they survived, but it's still a feat. I want to point that out. For our viewers, again, if you liked what you saw today, and you probably did because you're here at the end, click subscribe, click get notifications. Again, we will let you know every single time. Every time, I am not kidding, that we post something to the YouTube channel, which is very frequently. So, Allen, thanks so much for doing this today.
Thank you, Brad. It was just a lot of fun. We could go on, but we've got to do other things.
I know. My life could be director's cut, Allen. It really could. 24 hours a day. And once you start talking about farms, I'm in on that. I always say it's sports, music, and food, but farming I can get behind, too. So to all our viewers out there, thanks for watching till the end, and we will see you with a brand new Director's Cut next week.